Hey, welcome to Non-Standard Models, where we unravel the mysteries of theoretical physics. Today, I'm here with Markus Schulze and Hi. Daniele Artico.
Hi.
Markus is a researcher in particle physics, and Daniele is a PhD student at Humboldt University. Particle physicists study the fundamental building blocks of nature, the particles. But actually today, Markus and Daniele are going to tell us more about the connection between particle physics and dark matter. But what is dark matter? Well, in the past, scientists used to think that most of the mass of the universe was actually made up of planets, stars, and everything we see in the sky. But experiments in the 30s led them to understand that astronomical objects cannot account for the total mass of the galaxies. In fact, 85% of their mass is unexplained and not visible, precisely dark matter.
That's right. Nowadays, we still don't know what this dark matter is made of. Physicists have tried for almost a century to figure it out through astrophysics, cosmology, and particle physics.
Yes, indeed. So today we have many different candidate models for dark matter. However, many open questions remain, and we are still doing a lot of research on dark matter. In the last 50 years, physicists have searched in many different branches of physics for dark matter, for example, in quantum particle physics, cold planets, black holes, and so on. And as particle physicists today, we will focus on the particle nature of dark matter.
Well, I think we are really curious to hear about these particle models, and also, for example, to understand if we can produce dark matter in colliders, as we did for the Higgs particle. So let's find out. So let's start with a bit of historical context. The search for dark matter started in the 30s, but can you tell us more about the first actual evidence of the presence of dark matter?
Well, sure. The first observation leading to unexpected results was done in 1933 by the astrophysicist Fritz Zwicky. He was measuring the properties of clusters of galaxies, and we know from gravitational physics that the farther a galaxy is from the center, the slower it should evolve around it. But observation showed that these galaxies were moving faster than expected, so fast that they should have been flung away. Therefore, he concluded that the gravitational force generated by visible matter is not enough for explaining this weird behavior.
Although it's true that this was the first discovery of dark matter, it was considered an isolated problem at the time. Until the astronomer Vera Rubin came up, and she found a strange behavior in the rotation of stars in the galaxies. And this was the same effect that Zwicky found, just on a very different length scale. And she concluded that there has to be some dark material that contributes to the gravitational pull. And there had to be a lot of it. So 5 to 6 times more than we see in the visible matter. So slowly the puzzle started to gather its pieces.
So a single observation wasn't really enough to understand that something important was missing from our model of the universe. We needed 2 observations into different physical contexts to start to get a clue.
Even more than 2. So in the following years, more experiments were made and they found more evidence for dark matter. So for example, we see dark matter now in the way light is bending around large objects. We also see dark matter in the cosmic microwave background radiation that is coming from the Big Bang.
It sounds really interesting. Was it ever contemplated that some invisible astronomical objects were accounting for the missing mass?
Yeah, indeed it was. Actually, the first explanation was to identify these obscure materials with conventional astronomical objects with low luminosity, such as white dwarfs, black holes, or planets. But although these objects actually exist in our universe, their total mass cannot possibly account for the total dark matter mass that we need. Therefore, we started to imagine that this dark matter is made of new undiscovered constituents. In other words, new particles.
But since we never observed these hypothetical particles, can we still infer some of their properties?
We know very little about the particle properties of dark matter. We have to rely on a few facts. So the first one is that we know it is interacting with gravity like ordinary particles. Secondly, we have never seen light originating from dark matter. For us physicists, this means that dark matter is not interacting with a photon, the carrier of the electromagnetic force. And as a consequence, dark matter cannot be electrically charged. And finally, from models of galaxy formation, we know dark matter existed since the beginnings of the early universe in the same amounts as today. And from that we know dark matter is not decaying, it's not like a radioactive element.
Okay, so at least we have a sketch of the key features of these dark matter candidates. What about their mass?
Well, when astrophysicists study particles, they divide them into groups, hot and cold particles. Hot particles travel almost at the speed of light and they have small mass, while cold particles travel more slowly, but they have big mass. From models of galaxy formation, we actually assume that these dark matter candidates are heavy. This means that we assume dark matter is cold. But this is a hypothesis that still needs to be tested, and so people are also working in different directions.
It would be really amazing to solve these open questions by detecting dark matter. But since we know so little about its interaction, do you even think this is possible? And if so, how would an experiment be designed for this purpose?
Our expectation is that dark matter interacts with ordinary matter with extremely small likelihood. So there are already experiments aimed to discovering dark matter via those rare events. This is called direct detection. We try to observe dark matter colliding with some fluid particles we put in a container. The container is then put underground, so ordinary matter and radiation cannot reach the detector. This helps to detect more easily dark matter. Moreover, we fill in this tank with the most stable chemical elements in the universe, noble gases such as xenon. This helps to further reduce the chance of getting a false signal.
So with this experiment, we hope to detect those dark matter particles that travel through Earth and then bounce on xenon atoms. But we also know that throughout the last century, we discovered a lot of new particles produced with these particle accelerators like ALHC in Geneva. And from quantum physics, we actually know that if we have sufficient high energy in a collision, we can produce new particle. And it seems natural then to think that we can also apply this to dark matter.
Yes, indeed. So what we would actually measure in these experiments is something called missing energy. Let me explain this. There are some quantities that are always conserved in these collisions. And one of these quantities is the total energy. So we expect to measure the final energy and the initial energy of the collision to be the same, even if it is distributed amongst the different particles. And this doesn't seem to happen for dark matter production, because simply the detector wouldn't see these elusive particles. So the energy before the collision and after the collision would be different. And this indicates the production of dark matter.
Okay, so we know that energy must be conserved, but that's true also for momentum, no?
Sure, we also measure the total momentum before and after the collision, and energy and momentum are quantities that we take from classical physics. What we can do also is to measure properties that are present only at a very small scale, at the quantum level, like spin, which is the analogous of angular momentum. Different dark matter particles may have different spin and different quantum properties, and this can influence the outcome of the experiment.
Now that we better understand the properties of these dark matter candidates, I'm curious to know what are the models that satisfy these properties.
Yeah, well, there are two of the most promising models, which are the weakly interacting massive particles. They're called WIMPs, or something that we call axions. So we know that the forces that act between two particles are actually the exchange of another particle. So, for example, the electromagnetic force between two electrons is nothing but the exchange of a photon. WIMPs, as their name indicates, are interacting via a weak force. So a perfect candidate for dark matter would be a new species of neutrino, because they are interacting via the weak nuclear force. On the other hand, axions are interacting via the strong force. This is the strong force that keeps the atomic nucleus together via exchanging gluons. And we have a lot of freedom in building all these different models. And that's why the dark matter candidates have different properties and their strengths and weaknesses.
It seems there are still a lot of open questions, but that's why in the end this topic is so intriguing. It will be exciting to see how these ideas will develop in the future. And meanwhile, thanks Markus and Daniele for shedding some light in this dark topic. And thanks to you for watching. See you next time here on Non-Standard Models.